Good morning, friends. It's great to be able to gather with you folks in our virtual sanctuary here. And of course, right now, Dianne and I are on our own here in the sanctuary and recording for you folks for Sunday morning worship. And but you can worship anytime that you want with this this video. It doesn't have to be the morning. My name is Reverend Isaac. I'm the minister here at Trenton United Church. During the current lockdown and state of emergency in Ontario, most of our activities here at the church are not taking place in the building, but we know that the Spirit is alive and at work in our lives in so many different ways. And we want to thank you so much for the ways that you find to live out your faith, whether it is at home or whatever ways that you are connecting with those around you through phone calls and emails and messages. It's beautiful to see that we are still the body of Christ, even when we can't be gathered physically in this space. And we want to continue to thank all of you for your generous financial support. And we actually, you'll see in the email blast that went out this week, or you can check out our website at www.trentonunited.ca, or maybe it's just trentonunited.ca actually. But go there and look at the weekly message. Margot from our stewardship and finance committee has offered some good news. You folks responded so generously to our appeal at during the month of December, and while we still have a deficit at the end of the year, it is much smaller than it has been over the last little while. And so thank you, and we ask you, especially in these months as we move into January and February, that you continue in that spirit of generosity. And whether that's through pre-authorized remittance, whether that's through a check sent into the church or placed through the door at the front of up here, or whether it is through an email gift or through Canada Helps, we thank you for the so many different ways that you continue to support the ministry of God in this community through Trenton United Church. I'm going to just remind you, because we are in the state of emergency, Monday to Friday are my sort of regular work days until we get back to worshiping here in person on Sundays. And we know that at least until February 7th, and including February 7th, I believe that's a Sunday, we will be continuing to be having worship online and through text-based sheets that are going out only. We won't be gathering in person until at least after the state of emergency draws to a close. And of course, we have to keep our eyes and ears open to see whether there will be any extensions in that way. But our hope, at least at this point, is to be able to gather again starting about a month from now. But we'll see how things go in terms of the news, and know that we're keeping you all in our prayers as we move through this tough time. It's hard not to be able to be together, but we know we want to be able to do this in order to keep one another safe and to be able to move into a future where we're living in hope with these possibilities for the vaccines. And as they roll out, we'll look forward and hope to the possibilities that are there with those vaccines. Right now, we are still planning on having an annual meeting that will be taking place on March 7th. There's the possibility that it might not be in person at all, or there's also the possibility that it might be taking place for some online, and for others who aren't able to do so, to be able to gather in a socially distanced way to just make sure that we at least do the key things that we need to do each year for our annual meetings. So that is planned, at least for the moment, at March 7th, but we'll keep you posted. And a reminder to everybody who is creating reports for the annual report this year, we want you to have that into Catherine, our administrative assistant at the office. We want those reports in by February 9th, so make sure to get to work on those for those who are preparing reports, and I need to get to work on mine as well, and we'll have those into Catherine by February 9th. Reminder too that this coming Tuesday we have a spiritual life meeting which will be taking place on Zoom at 6:30, and the link for that will be going out in the next little bit to those who are on our spiritual life committee. You know, I believe that those are all the announcements that I wanted to bring to your attention this morning. So we'll enter into a time of passing the peace. I don't know about for you folks, for myself, I've been finding that sometimes moving through these weeks, especially since lockdowns and emergency measures have come into place, sometimes it feels like we're just kind of swimming through molasses. And I've said that to several different folks, but you know, as we enter into worship, we want to really have a sense that we are emerging from that heaviness that is there. And so here's what we're going to do for passing the peace today. We're going to kind of do like a bit of a breaststroke passing the peace to you folks who are there. And so I'll do that. And you know what? Actually, I'm going to do a deep dive. I'll come back up and then I'll pass the peace over to you folks. Okay, so here I go. Peace of Christ to you. Peace of Christ, Diane. All right. Well, let's begin our time with our candle lighting prayer. And if you are following along at home in the worship document that has been sent out through the email blast, you can join in speaking these words with me as we light the Christ candle in our midst. Let's speak these words together. When our eyesight grows dim, and visions are not widespread, Christ Jesus, you come and light a fire in the darkness. As we light our Christ candle, illuminate our lives. In pain, in joy, in giving and receiving, we open our hearts to you. Amen. And in the spirit of that opening, let's gather ourselves now to sing number 79 in More Voices. Spirit, open my heart. Spirit, open my heart to the joy and pain of living. As you love, may I love. Receiving and in giving, Spirit, open my heart. God, replace my stony heart with a heart that's kind and tender. The coldness and fear to your grace I now serve. Spirit, open my heart to the joy and pain of living. As you love, may I love in receiving and in giving. Spirit, open my heart. Write your love upon my heart. As my love, my goal, my story, in each thought, word, and deed, may my living bring you glory. Spirit, open my heart to the joy and pain of living. As you love, may I love. In receiving and in giving, Spirit, open my heart.
May I weep with those who weep, share the joy of sister, brother, in the welcome of Christ. May we welcome one another. Spirit, open my heart to the joy and pain of living. As you love, may I love in receiving and in giving. Spirit, open my heart.
Folks, our first reading from Scripture for today comes from the first book of Samuel, chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. And in these opening chapters of Samuel, we've heard about how a priest, Eli, welcomes a woman named Hannah, and at first is suspicious of her, but then realizes that God is at work in her life and hears her prayer, and she gives birth in the end to Samuel, and promises that he can go and live in the temple with Eli. And we hear in this story a story about listening for God's voice and how Samuel and Eli hear that voice. So let's listen to these words of Scripture now together. Now, the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore, Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." May God bless our understanding of this reading as we reflect together and as Dianne leads us in our ministry of music. stand. Friends, I'll invite you to join me in a moment of prayer before we enter into our time for reflection for this morning. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. So, folks, early in my life as a minister, and in the first few years, I was working a lot in youth ministry, and we decided as a church to be able to embark on a project that we were going to partner with a local community center in order to be able to put on an open mic coffee house for youth in our area. And the idea was that we would be gathering young people together. They would arrive and they would be able to sing songs and offer pieces of poetry if they wanted, or do a dance or tell a joke. And the sense of being able to share together in community and to create a more vibrant sense of youth community in our area. We were pretty excited about the possibility of this project. We got a grant to be able to work on this, and we had all the resources that we felt like we would need in order to pull this off. We had all kinds of video screens and sound equipment. We had pizza that we were going to be ordering, and different desserts and staff support, free bus tickets if people needed to be able to have help with transportation. And we advertised with posters all over town, and we also advertised on social media as well. And the big first night arrived, and we were looking forward to it. And a handful of teens showed up, and you know, we shared in a time together that was good. And we got ready for the next week, hoping that there was going to be a big surge of, next month, hoping that there would be a big surge of more people coming for the coffee house. And unfortunately, the next one, there was only one young person who showed up. And now, I don't want to say that it wasn't great to be able to connect with that one young person. It's always valuable. We know that where two or three are gathered in God's name, that God is there. At the same time, while the person was grateful and happy, I don't know if they were that thrilled to be singing their song to really basically an empty room in terms of the gathering. And I have to say, I was feeling a little bit discouraged at that point, that it didn't seem like this was catching on and that people were interested and engaging in things. And it felt like our vision had stalled in a kind of a way. But at one point in the midst of that second evening, and at the end when I was feeling kind of down, one of the other youth workers came and talked to me, a youth worker from the community center. And she gave me some advice that I often think about and think back to. She said, you know what, I like this project and I think it can work, but it's so important when you're working with young people to make sure to go out and meet them where they are and connect with them in a personal way and one-on-one and message them and let them know that you want them to be a part of this project. And I think that they want to be a part of this project too, but you have to build that relationship and make those connections one by one as you move along. And I took those words. I was still a bit skeptical and whether the vision could come into fruition, but what I did for the next month's session was I ended up messaging a number of the young people who were connected to the youth center and let them know about what was happening, saying that we would love to have them with us. And that coming month, there were more young people who ended up coming. And then the following month, there were a few more after that. And as we began to engage with these young people, we made sure to ask them, what are the things that you are interested in terms of how this coffee house could work? And I and the other leaders always made sure to connect with each person who had gotten up to sing and to speak or to dance, and connect with them afterwards and let them know how much we loved what they were doing and talking about what we appreciated about their performance. We had a real sense that God was at work in terms of the different forms of expression that were there. And it was amazing. Once we started making those connections in all of these different ways, it grew and it grew. And within a year, we were having 60 young people showing up for these events, some of them just coming to watch their friends sing or do their thing. But Our roster was always full for the 2 hours that were happening, and we had this deep sense of community being formed. And what was really wonderful too is that these young people, some of them ended up becoming leaders in some of the children's and youth programs that were going on back at our church, and they started to nurture the life and the love that is being shared for people who were young people in our congregation. So I would say that in many ways it was a success story, but I always feel like it's important for me to remember those humble beginnings of how things had started off. When I read the scripture passage for today and we hear about Eli and his sight is dim and the word of God is not well known around him and visions are not widespread, I end up thinking about those early days of the coffee house where we weren't sure whether our vision was going to be able to be fruitful. It's interesting in this story of Eli and Samuel that we heard read. It's interesting to see the ways that for Eli, even though he had all the resources of the temple, and we learn too, if you kind of read a bit around the other passages around the scripture passage, we learn that for Eli, some of his entourage start kind of taking these gifts of the temple for granted, and it's not a great situation. But perhaps there's so much of a reliance there that there's a forgetfulness about the importance of relationship when it comes to the life of faith. And so the first few times when Samuel hears that voice saying, "Samuel, Samuel," when he goes to Eli thinking that it's Eli, Eli just kind of brushes him off and sends him away and doesn't pay attention to the needs and the possibilities of relationship that are there. But eventually, he catches on. He catches on that this small spark, this voice that Samuel is hearing, is in fact the presence of God. And he helps to fan that small spark into a flame that then begins to allow Samuel to become the person that he is called to be as a person of faith and as a leader amongst the people of Israel. Now, we know during this time of darkness in our current lockdown that probably for a lot of us, it can feel as though a word of comfort from God is hard to hear. And we know too that oftentimes it can feel as though visions are not widespread. I know for myself, as I said, it just feels like things are a little bit heavier in so many different aspects of our lives. And for myself, I think I have that tendency, like Eli, to maybe at first rely on having a sense of comfort and safety by relying on the things that I have, whether those are physical, material things or my emotional different ways of dealing things from the past. And yet, I think it's so important for us to remain open to the possibilities still, even in lockdown, of relationship. And I think that for each one of us, we are still called to remember the ways that God is at work in the lives of those around us. God is already there planting these little seeds, these voices in people around us. And we are called to be people like Eli, who are aware that God is at work in the world and to nurture those sparks and those ways of growing that are already present in folks, but just need a little bit of help to move individuals along closer to that love and that voice of justice in who God is. Now, I've been amazed at the many different ways that so many of you folks have found creative and safe ways of connecting with one another, with children or grandchildren, or sometimes strangers or people who are shut in, using either reaching out electronically or picking up the phone. There are so many different ways that nurture can take place. I know as a parent right now, as challenging as it has been in terms of online learning and figuring all of that out, I'm amazed by the teachers and by our principal and by different support staff and different folks actually like Dianne, who do incredible work in the background that you don't always see on the screen, but who do amazing technical work for the school board in our local area. We are so blessed to have those folks who are helping to nurture our young people, to nurture our young people and to let them grow. We can be a part of that too, with young people, but also with people of any age. We need to remember that we're called not just to rely on the things that we have, but we're called to reach out in relationship, to find those small points of connection with those around us. And obviously we can't be in the physical same space, but there are still ways that we can do that. And when we do that, that spark that is there can grow into something that is beautiful, that warms the world around us, and that offers God's brightness in new ways that we might never even have expected beforehand. And what's beautiful too is when we take the time to nurture those small sparks too. I think that that warms the flames of our own hearts as well, and allows us to, even when it's dark, to move forward with the sense that there's enough light to be able to take one step ahead of the other. Friends, we can trust in these relationships because we know we draw on the relationship that we have with the one who loves us, with the one who creates us. Make sure to listen for that voice in your life. Even when things are hard, know that that voice is still speaking, that the light, that the lamp of the Lord has not yet gone out and will not go out in our own hearts. And we can respond by saying, "Here I am, and thanks be to God." Amen. As Dianne leads us in music, let us gather ourselves in prayer. God of vision, open our eyes that we might see that even when the world is locked down, you place in our hands the wonderful key that unlocks freedom and justice in our own lives and in the lives of those around us. Help us not to lean so heavily on the things that we have, and instead guide us to place our trust in our relationships with you and with your children across this earth. Open our ears to your voice of advocacy for those in our world who have borne the worst of this pandemic. We pray for families struggling to find ways to mourn loved ones lost. We pray for those living and working in environments where physical distancing is so difficult, in long-term care homes, in homeless shelters, in prisons, in migrant worker residences, and in refugee camps. We pray for those who are cared for and work in ICUs, in hospitals, both here in our region and around the world. Silently now, we wait for you, God. We ask that you open the mouths of those in our midst whose voices we often do not hear. Empower us to encourage the witness of children, of those new to the faith, of those who have yet to realize how much you cherish them. May their hearts be transformed, and may we also be transformed by your prophetic word through them, as we pray the prayer that Christ taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Well, if you are following along at home and have your voices united there with you, let's sing together number 509, "I, the Lord of Sea and Sky." I, the Lord of sea and and sky.
I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in deepest sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have borne my people's pain. I have wept for love of them, they turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead. Your people in my heart.
Friends, we'll take time now to both bless our offerings and bless one another with a sense that we are present to one another through all the gifts of creation. Deep peace of the running wave to you. Deep peace of the flowing air to you. Deep peace of the quiet earth to you. Deep peace of the shining stars to you. Deep peace of the gentle night to you. Moon and stars pour their healing light on you. Deep peace of Christ, the light of the world to you. Amen. And friends, as you move out from this virtual space and into wherever life might bring you, we invite you to have a sense that God is at work in your life, but that you can also be that one who hears the voice of God and knows that that voice is speaking to those around you, that that spark is there present in those whom you have contact with. And together, let us be a people that allows that spark to grow into a flame, to warm the world, and to offer light in places of darkness. Friends, go from this place in peace.